People who visit Assisi almost always make their way to San Damiano and visit the ancient chapel that was first to be restored by St. Francis. Inside the little church, which has not been modified throughout the centuries, there used to be a crucifix in the time of Francis. This crucifix can now be admired and venerated in the Basilica of St. Clare, and is known throughout the world as the Crucifix or the Cross of San Damiano. The account goes that one day Francis went out to the fields to meditate. As he was passing by the church of San Damiano, which was almost in ruin, he was moved by the Spirit to enter and pray. Prostrate before the image of the crucified, he prayed, and his spirit was filled with consolation. And while with tears in his eyes he gazed upon the Lord on the cross, he heard with his bodily ears a voice coming from the cross, which told him three times, "Francis, go and repair my house, which, as you can see, is falling into ruin." Contemplating the icon of San Damiano, our attention is immediately drawn to the figure of Christ crucified that dominates the entire surface of the painting, not just because of the size of the image, but also due to its brilliant colors in contrast to the black background. Black, in the iconography of that period, signified death, or represented the devil. Upon careful observation of the crucifix, we notice that the dominant colors used by the painter are red and gold. Both of these indicate divinity and eternity. There are also blue and green, which reference the world and the course of human history. Finally, we will notice that the icon is bordered by a series of shells. These shells express the supernatural and eternal characteristic of what is painted inside their frame. Despite the drama of the scene, the Saviour fastened to the wood of the cross, one has the impression that Christ lives and that his body is resplendent with the lustre characteristic of the one who has vanquished death. We observe that there is no crown of thorns upon the Lord's head. Rather, in its place, there is a golden halo inscribed with a Greek cross. The face of Jesus is covered by a very delicate veil, almost a shadow that abates his gaze upon humankind. The eyes, large and open, confirm that Christ who died upon the cross is alive. Death no longer has power over him. Paying close attention, we notice a slight smile emerging on his lips. The head, adorned by long hair, is slightly turned to the left. These details underscore the humanity of the Christ who has vanquished death. Some see in the lines of the forehead the image of a dove, the Holy Spirit. It is important to note that this type of iconography requires that the person's neck be painted quite large to indicate their importance. The neck is robust enough to bear the power of the spirit that it breathes. In this icon of San Damiano, the neck of Jesus is so large to the point of being disproportionate. The arms, despite their suffering, are stretched out as a sign of welcome. The legs are strong, they hold up the body in a vertical position. This way of standing indicates that Jesus is powerful, and he announces God's victory over death. The perizoma, or the undergarment, wrapped around the waist of Christ, does not resemble the rag with which the private parts of the condemned were covered. We see instead a linen undergarment embroidered with gold, almost a priestly vestment worn when coming before the people, imploring God's forgiveness upon everyone. We cannot omit speaking about the wounds in the hands, feet, and side. Blood flows from these for the redemption of the world. Above the inscription we see the figure of the risen Jesus who ascends into heaven. I go to my Father and your Father, my God and your God. The image shows Jesus in an ascending motion. He is covered with a long mantle, which is the symbol of resurrection. In his left hand, the Savior holds a cross, symbol of his victory over death. The right hand, on the other hand, is raised upwards towards God the Father. Around his head, the artist has painted the nimbus of glory. If we pay close attention to the scene, we will notice that Christ's open eyes, so full of trust and peace, are turned towards the Father, who with his hand and blessing raises up the Son from death, and at the same time blesses all of the Savior's work in this world. Angels and archangels surround the entire scene of Christ's ascension. Their faces are resplendent with joy because Christ has conquered death and now returns to the house of the Father. Their wings, heads and arms are in movement. Their hands are open in greeting. We can certainly affirm that this is the most animated and glorious scene in the whole icon. We also notice two more groups of angels represented around the wounded and bloody hands of the Savior. In their faces, however, we find emotion and compassion. Based on their gestures and the looks on their faces, it would seem that they are speaking among themselves, commenting, broadcasting directly the events of the crucifixion. The crucifixion of Christ and his resurrection are an absolute novel and unique reality in the entire plan of salvation. On the base of the cross, we see two visible figures that some claim to be St. John and St. Michael. The other four figures that are barely visible next to the two images, according to one hypothesis, are Saints Rufino, John the Baptist, Peter and Paul. The abrasions on the painted canvas are probably due to the popular devotion that never tires of touching the object of veneration. Under the outstretched arms of Jesus, we see two groups of people. They are the witnesses of the crucifixion of Christ, and at the same time, the people closest to him. The first group on the left is made up of the mother of Jesus and Saint John, the beloved disciple. It was to him that Jesus, dying upon the cross, entrusted his mother. On the right, we find the figures of Mary Magdalene, Mary, mother of James, and the centurion. In the whole scene, Mary touches her own cheek with her left hand, and she points to Saint John with her right hand. He in turn points to Jesus. Mary Magdalene makes a similar gesture to that of Mary. The Roman centurion in Mark's Gospel declares, "Truly, this man was the Son of God." He holds his hand in the classic demeanor of the Christian witness. The three fingers elongated on the right hand represent a true confession and signify, "I declare that Jesus Christ is Lord." Another interpretation identifies this figure as the centurion in Luke's Gospel. "I did not consider myself worthy to come to you, but say the word and my servant will be healed." Yet another interpretation affirms that the small head appearing behind the centurion is the son who was healed, according to John's Gospel in the passage that ends, "He, with his entire family, came to believe." Therefore, the small faces in the background would be the family of the royal official. We have even more explanations of this small, almost hidden figure, the servant who attentively fixed his gaze on his master and on Jesus. When St. Francis would enter into a church, he would pray thus, as is remembered in his testament: "We adore you, most holy Lord Jesus Christ, here and in all of your churches around the world, and we praise you because by your holy cross you have redeemed the world." It is with this simple reflection that I would like to end. The icon of the call and vocation of Francis can be the icon of our own vocation. We are also called to give witness. Through his passion, death, and resurrection, Christ shows us the way that he underwent before ascending into heaven. He has walked for us the path of our redemption. We need to accept, therefore, our own cross. Gaze upon the cross. How much comfort and what an invitation we find in that: "Go and repair my house." It is not easy to deny such an invitation.